What a wonderful time to be a business person. Of course, it's no doubt that as Christmas comes closer, everyone is looking to spend in order to celebrate the end of the year. This now involves bandwagon shopping, which is not ideal for you looking to save money, but is ideal for a businessman looking to make extra cash. So when you're shopping, make sure to look out for promotions, but also make sure you stick to the budget. Welcome to the Business Show. First, let's take a look at what's trending in the world of business. Kenya oil dealers get billions in fund to keep fuel prices unchanged. IGAD unveils 3.8 trillion Kenyan shillings infrastructure plan. Africa's cannabis industry predicted beyond $7 billion valuation by 2023. And US to release oil reserves in attempt to lower the prices.
Our startup runs on a budget of roughly around $1,500 at the minimum a month. But the government's gazetted funds is to give around 200,000.
From 9 months and above, but the best wine should be 1 year and above.
Once again, welcome to the show. Now, working remotely calls for recruiting, meetings, and at times, even final delivery on a project. This week on Views from the Top, we look at a platform that gives exactly these services to be able to help people working from home adapt to it. We speak to a co-founder and chief operations officer, Wape.
My name is Collins Mbolachalo, and I am a co-founder and COO at Wapi. And Wapi is an online talent marketplace that connects people with digital skills to remote work online, and we call ourselves Africa's talent marketplace. Since March 2020, when the world stood still and basically work went remote, it was closely about around the same period when we were almost starting as a company. And for context, Wapi started within the heart of COVID, or within the heart of the pandemic, in June 2020. And we started as a fully remote team and have been operating as fully remote since then. What that meant for us is that as a team spread across the country, as a team of young students who are studying from different universities, we were able to build and work on a company without necessarily having to meet. So the pandemic made that a reality. Remote work previously was just a talk, and it was a possibility for some workplaces that they thought they could have. But when the pandemic hit, remote work became more than just an option, but it also became the only option we had then. And with that, we were able to find ways of also minimizing costs as a company, from hiring an office space, from transportation and commuting, and getting to work on things. But besides the benefits that come with working remotely and within the context of Uganda more specifically, we saw that as a remote team there were some challenges we were facing. One of those challenges was the internet coverage. Because we have daily meetings online, we have to sync up and be connected and know what everyone is working on. We can only do that remotely through these online calls on either Zoom or Google Meet. But you'll find that sometimes we have colleagues dropping off the calls because the internet connection is not steady, or the very common question of, I can't hear you, or are you hearing me now, or you're breaking, and many of these things. And these are subjects of how good the quality of internet is across the entire country. Some areas within Kampala have amazing internet connectivity, but also the bundles maybe are more affordable and they're more stable. While in other areas, partly we had some team members in Bara, we had a team member in Jinja, you'd find that sometimes the connectivity in those areas isn't as good. And what that means is that we're not able to communicate effectively as a remote team, and business isn't able to go on as usual. I I think the biggest lesson has been that talent can be found anywhere. And this is because our team currently now has people in Nigeria, we have a team member in South Africa, we have a team member in Kenya, and then most of the team is in Uganda. But even within Uganda, we're spread across Mbarara, Jinja, and Kampala. And the interesting fact about that is you can meet various amazing people with talent spread across the country and work on the same goal, which is very beautiful. The disadvantage that we now also learn with that is if, like I've said, the connectivity isn't as stable, it can prove to be disastrous for the team's communication, because remote teams strive on amazing communication. And without that, then there are going to be problems that prevent progression in a good way. So the other learning was that communication is important, and for that to happen, there needs to be proper connectivity. I think what the government could do is really put in incentives or subsidies with the current providers, right? And personally, the way I see it, that could apply on two levels: the pricing and also infrastructure to enable expansion of better coverage. Pricing in what way? We've seen the Tanzanian government go ahead to actually put caps on how much these internet companies can charge their citizens. Our government could do the same. They could put in policies that prevent these internet companies from exploiting us and hiking prices any way they want. That's one step that they could take, and one step that's actually possible, a very pragmatic way of doing it. Then the second would be, how can they support the current providers to ensure that their coverage is able to spread across the country, right? Are they putting in incentives or subsidies for them to say that, okay, if MTN, Airtel, and maybe other networks have 4G in these areas, we shall maybe tax them less for having 4G coverage in this area, right? That way they are then giving incentives to these networks to actually try and expand their coverage and make quality available. It's not easy at all for a startup like ours to access these resources. And it's dependent on many factors. One, our economy is run on a lot of bureaucracy, but also a lot of technical know-how, right? Who do you know to get you into those meetings, into those places to access these funds? But these resources are there, yes. The government has gazetted funds, it has put the money there for people to get. But in order to get this money, you have to run through loops and holes and paperwork and all these other things. Yes, they say it's necessary for this paperwork to happen, but you see, that's the very problem right there. If the more barriers that exist for startups to access this funding, the harder it is going to be for us to get it, right? But the other thing then is, what type of funding is available? You see that our startup runs on a budget of roughly around $1,500 at the minimum a month. But the government's gazetted funds is to give around 200,000, which is roughly $70 per startup to run for an entire year. It cannot add up. While working from home, personally, I have an office set up. I have an ergonomic chair that I purchased. I have a table that was made for me, and I invested in making sure that my home office setup is as comfortable. But there is actually indeed a concern that other people who are working from home might not have that same setup, or maybe can't even afford the same setup. So it is indeed a very valid concern that health-wise, it can be a risk, mostly in terms of sitting posture, in terms of exposure to screen time, because you realize when you're at home, it's hard for you to distinguish between this is off work hours and then these are home hours. You'll probably wake up, take a shower, sit on your table, work up to even 9 p.m. While as before, you'd wake up in the morning, go to the office 8 a.m., leave the office at 5 p.m., you've shut down your laptop, you know you're going home to rest. But in these situations, you then find yourself even going up to 9 p.m., 10 p.m., and you're still on that laptop. So there needs to be probably a way people find a balance between closing their offices at home and then calling it a day. I think the future of work is definitely going to be hybrid. even when things get back to normal. We are seeing major companies, not only just within Uganda, we are seeing the likes of Google, Facebook, giving their employees the openness of working fully remotely. Now, these are companies that have employees in the thousands, in the millions, right? So if they have been able to see the benefit of working remotely, then I think it's going to become a world phenomenon, right? And what then makes this even better is the internet speeds and coverage. Countries that are adopting 5G, countries that have better connectivity, are most probably going to be remote faster than those with less connectivity, right? Because with the better internet connectivity, the better conditions for you to work remote and actually communicate effectively. So if we also adopt that same trend within Uganda, which I believe we are on track of doing, then definitely the future of work is still going to be hybrid, or even at some point it will be mostly remote. You'll find that many companies, close to maybe 60%, are going remote because it will save them money. It will give the people who are working in these companies the ability to work in a comfortable environment, because with remote work, you're also able to maybe today take a flight and go and work from Nairobi, which you can't do in a physical workspace, right? So some of these luxuries, some of these beauties, this peace that comes with working remotely are going to be the benefits that people are looking out for in a workplace, and workplaces that don't adopt them will probably not attract the best talent. So therefore, it will be something that has to happen and has to be. Another challenge would be mental health, really, is what I can share. And at times it's put under the carpet, but mental health is going to be a very important thing that people need to be fully aware of, because work stress mixed with home stress can make someone probably go crazy. That is why you would see sometimes people wouldn't want to go back home early. They're trying to avoid the stress that comes with it. I think the first step we can take to prepare for the future of remote work is by moving with technology that supports us to pull off what we need to make remote work a success. What that can look like is by one, adopting the work of working with freelancers who are primarily online, right? These are people who have mastered the art of remote work. They are very good at it, and they are well placed to then provide services in such a situation. The second thing is to also, like I've already shared, internet connectivity and all that, but companies and individuals need to become open to using services that provide this very need that they're looking for, right? Because versus the common way of hiring people full-time to come to your offices, we need to then scale up and be open to the idea of hiring someone online and remotely that you haven't worked with before, to take on part-time gigs, to be used within this remote work, right? And what this will then do is improve on our economy, and improving on our economy then enables people afford these services like better internet, and improving on that better internet will then lead to the remote work that we're looking for. And that's part of what we are looking to address at WAPI, right? We want to enable individuals become their best versions of themselves remotely, but also to support our people within Uganda to hire these people and set up the country for success with remote work.
Thank you for staying with us. We take a short break now, but there is still so much more to come.